comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. These are the shouts of the crowds greeting Jesus as he enters Jerusalem on a colt. These are the shouts of the people acclaiming to this one a royal welcome to greet him as he comes and to send him on his way. And these are the words that we say or that we sing week after week at our communion table. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And this is where it all begins. This is where it all comes from. Palm Sunday, Passion Sunday, this initiation of Holy Week, the recitation of a story so tragic that many of us would rather skip ahead to next week already, saying, give me palms, give me hosannas, and then give me an empty tomb and a resurrected Lord. Because in a week where children have been gassed and violence has been set in place in all kinds of ways, the story in between these two Sundays is too hard for us to bear. It's just too dark. It's too upsetting. But today is the day. The day when it all gets set in motion. The day when, on the flip side of our hosannas, we feel those painful words, crucify him, welling up inside us somehow. Despite the love that we feel, despite the high hopes that we have, despite our devotion and our dedication to discipleship, we know it's within us, that potential for betrayal. And so we just want to skip ahead. Fast forward through the dark parts. Blame the religious authorities and Pilate and Judas and simply believe ourselves innocent. In Matthew's telling of the tale today, our focus comes to Judas. Now, while writings and films have long sought to fill in the gaps of this mysteriously underdeveloped character, from a gospel perspective, we know very little about him. We know he must have been trusted a great deal, as the disciples made him their treasurer. We know he may have been sitting at that Passover meal right next to Jesus, because Jesus' words make it sound as though he and Judas were sharing a bowl. And to sit next to Jesus would imply that he was not just trusted, but that he was greatly honored. And yet he is one bound by this legacy of betrayal. Did he do it just for the money, we wonder? Was he somehow disappointed in this movement that he had joined? Did he not ultimately believe that Jesus was Lord? Nothing in Matthew's or the other Gospels' depictions give us a reason, which is perhaps what terrifies us the most. Because we know that we reserve our harshest judgment for those who commit acts of betrayal. Sadly, we get used to violence. We forgive selfishness, but there's something about betrayal. It haunts us, perhaps because it leaves us wondering, could that have been me? Craig Barnes, who is a Presbyterian pastor and he's the president of Princeton Theological Seminary, he once posed this question. He wondered, could it be that the real reason that we show betrayers so little compassion is that we're afraid that there is some Judas chromosome within all of us? Could it be that we fail to forgive because we fear we're capable of the very same thing. At the Last Supper, when Jesus told the disciples that one of them would betray him, each and every one of them responded saying, "Surely not I, Lord." See, they didn't simply brush off Jesus' words, because like us, that anxiety within all their souls rushed to the surface. They knew they were capable. They simply prayed that they'd controlled it. But as it turns out, in Jesus' last hours, none of the disciples was a model of faithfulness. Some couldn't stay awake while their distraught Savior prayed in the garden. Peter denied him 3 times before the cock crowed. None attended to the body of Jesus after the crucifixion. One by one, they failed him. They each betrayed him in ways both small and large. And yet it all began with hosannas. It all began with palms waving, with laud and honor, with a subversive parade where a carpenter was treated like a king. But that Palm Sunday road leads us each and every year to this place, to that table, to the Passover meal where Jesus broke bread and poured wine, where he washed feet, and where he imagined how this ragtag ministry could go on forever in living bread. And week after week at that table, we are invited to say with the palms in our hearts waving high, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." Now, many a sermon had been preached on how the crowd that could earlier in the week recite Hosanna would shout "Crucify him" only a few days later. And as unlikely as it is that those were the same crowds, it nonetheless gets to the heart of what terrifies us in this story. That Judas chromosome, as Craig Barnes describes it, that potential for betrayal, that deep-seated proclivity toward deception, where with the crowd we might shift from palm-waving reverie to violence. One of the messages that we get in Holy Week is that, yes, every disciple will eventually betray Jesus, just as every one of us will. We'll betray him at our workplace or at school when it will cost us too much to think and behave like a Christian. We'll betray him in our homes when anger and frustration make us so blind that we hurt those who trust us. We'll betray Jesus by our indifference to the poor and our inability to turn the other cheek. Just like the disciples, we too will betray him. And yet we're reminded week after week that our road will always lead us to this table. Week after week, we're going to pull up a place at that table and we're going to hear Christ's vision again. We'll come and we will remember the goodness of God despite our brokenness. We're going to come and, like the disciples, we will know our weaknesses. We will know our potential for betrayal. We'll know that we've already fallen short, and yet nonetheless, we will cry as if waving palms in our hands. "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." Because despite whatever brokenness might dwell in us, we will also claim the great mystery of our faith. do. This great mystery remains true. Christ is died, but Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. To which we say,